What advice could you give her, like, right now, in terms of, hey, you can take the risk and don't have that parental guilt?
That if Zandy spoke to 70, 80, 90 year old people, not named me, and not someone who is her grandfather or mother, a non-relative.
Yeah.
That if she spent a lot, if she's had five conversations with anyone who's 80 years old and asked them about life, the number one thing she would extract is you don't want to live life for regret.
Absolutely.
The thing I would say to Zandy is if you quit now working at Miller or Nike in Johannesburg or Cape Town, wherever you are, and it doesn't work out, this dream that you have that's making you want to jump, well, good news. You can always go and work for Procter & Gamble or Unilever or Kraft. The thing that people that tend to be stuck in a corporate environment don't understand is that the world has done a very effective job to tell you that you having a gap in your resume is bad at a time when having a gap in your resume is good.
Yes, exactly. Because resumes are supposed to, oh, we say CVs back home,
right?
CVs need to look a certain way.
That's right.
I was saying to him, like, I started out as a DJ, and then I was like, I cannot be a 40-year-old DJ. And I took that and made it into a CV. I still, to this day, even for my latest job, they were like, what's that gap? But I made it a positive story.
Well, that's right. And more importantly, like, the world's changing. This company, we've never required a college degree. I have no clue where these two gentlemen went to college. Did you go to college, Justin?
Oops.
You know what I mean? Like it doesn't even cross my mind.
It's a non-factor.
And so the world's moving, and so if you play your life by yesterday's rules, you're in trouble.
Absolutely.
You're better off playing your life on today's rules with an eye towards tomorrow's rules. And so what I would tell Zandy and anybody else is either you won't do it and you'll regret it your whole life, or you will do it, it'll either go phenomenal and be the great gift, or you'll lose, and at least you tried, and now you can go back to a job.
And you know the fun thing is when you go back, because I did a stint in entrepreneurship, it actually just makes you smarter to handle your P&L, right? Because you're like, I handle the risk on my own.
Yeah, a lot of people are being humbled in the last 10 years of not being capable of being entrepreneurs, and that's okay. I was with a creator today at an event who has amassed millions and millions of followers through ice cream, and viral ice cream guy. He thought, like, oh, let me go build an ice cream store too. He realized he couldn't. And so now he's back to doing full time, and that's great.
That's great.
That's not a loss. That's not a scarlet letter.
Absolutely.
As a matter of fact, it's gonna make people realize that entrepreneurs who could pull it off, it's a very small, rare talent.
Absolutely.
And I don't think I'm special for that. That's like an athlete or a singer or an artist. Like, everyone has different skills, and so I would say that if it's burning inside of you and you want to try, you must, because regret is the ultimate poison in life. I want to remind people, you're in control.
Yeah.
It's incredibly important and appropriate, and I appreciate, especially being very cordial, for people to ask and things of that nature, but I want to remind people, they're in control.
Yeah.
I want to provide value and put out things in my professional career. I'm incredibly private. And feel that the world is entitled to what you give it. So when I watch people get upset when people get into their business, I'm like, you're giving them your business. By the way, you're leveraging your business. I don't want to leverage nor give my personal life to the world. I don't think that's the right way. By the way, I just think it's my way. So the reason I have a little bit to what you're referring to is it became not sustainable because it's been a long time, and like I was in a transit, like it was the appropriate time.
Yeah.
And I needed to just get some context out there, but it's not where I'm gonna go.
Yeah, and that's what I was more interested by. To me, it's not.
Listen, us being together, my brain goes into maximize the value at the highest levels because we have the opportunity to for as many people are listening. The takeaway there from my perspective is you're in control.
Yeah.
You have a learning disability and you want to share it, mazel tov. You don't, great.
Yeah.
It took me back to something less serious. It took me 15 years of public life to say I'm not candorous. And it's hurt me in my personal life and it's hurt me in my business life. You get to share what you want to share.
Yeah.
And I think people should be careful of what they share.
Yes.
You share your abs as you're a good shaped dude, people are gonna talk about your body for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
But you did that. Yeah. You're gonna show your kid all the time, they're gonna talk about that. Relationship, they're gonna talk. You're giving the world permission.
Yeah.
I prefer not to give the world permission because that's a sacred place for me.
Yeah.
You know, even look at my mom. She, like, the greatest gift I could give to the world is my mom to the world. The greatest. She's alpha me. She's more experienced. She's a different perspective as a mom. She doesn't want it. The end. Right? I thought my dad and mom would be reverse. My dad, I never thought would love the limelight so much. But, you know, so I think if you're listening right now, please, if you're not going on social media because you have a skeleton in your closet, you have a disease, you have a bad, you know, situation, you're like me and like grew up in a family where like personal life is private. That's, I think, you know, in Russia, that was like, people would go to jail if anybody knew anything about you. So I think it ingrained in my parents, which then ingrained in me and my sister and brother, like we're private that way. You know, I think you have to understand you're in control. Facebook and TikTok and podcasts and YouTube don't make you do anything.
Yeah.
They don't make you do anything.
I'm so glad you addressed that because I think there's, and this is why I brought it up, I think there's been a mask of false vulnerability that's been encouraged because of social media. So people think that the more vulnerable or more open you are, that shows authenticity.
Yeah, I totally disagree. Vulnerability, I love you for that. Right? You're going to a very smart place. Yeah. I would argue I see more lack of authenticity in the way that people are leveraging their family and personal life because they know it does well. I think the lack of accountability is leading to so much unhappiness. Mm-hmm. Like life is so much better when you're like, this was my fault.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're in control.
Yeah.
And so like, you know, this was like a wrap up to control. You're in control, you. Yeah. You decide what you consume. You decide what you believe. You decide who you surround yourself with. You decide what you put out. Take on accountability.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to blame right now. Yeah, the algorithm. They're acting as the algorithms are like hypnosis. Mm-hmm. And I understand endorphin hits and all that, but like you can delete the app. Mm-hmm. You can. Like where's accountability in this?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Like
no,
we have alcohol, we have tobacco, we have drugs, we have weapons, and we have all sorts of issues, but most people play within moderation. That's on you.
Yeah. And it's a tough truth, right? It's a tough truth. It's a tough truth.
Especially when you're unhappy.
Yeah, yeah.
That goes back to why it's important. It's like the chicken and egg. It's like working out. Like I got into better shape the last 8 years. Nothing comes less natural to me.
Yeah, tell me.
Nothing
that.
Comes less
relate.
Natural
I
to me.
I can relate to you.
Right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
like
yeah.
But like, I was like, I just would like to live longer.
Yes.
I would just like to live longer.
They're sitting there and they're like, oh, I just feel like I'm not included with culture. But here's you. Every single week, you're putting yourself out there. Any words of advice for the brand managers that just feel I can't keep up with culture and the insights?
That there's no choice.
Hmm. Mm.
You know, when I hear people say, well, I can't keep up with another platform as a creator, like, Gary, I don't want to post on these. Like, all you're doing is you're limiting your upside.
Absolutely.
And I think, look, I think the reason most brand marketing is very bad is because I do think that most brand managers and CMOs live in ivory towers and boardrooms and have no idea what's actually happening to their consumer and are more worried about their customer, meaning the retailer that sells their stuff, than the customer that buys it from that retailer.
Exactly, Joe's Tavern and not, you know, Chava that's buying the Castle Lights.
That's right, and so for me, the reason I'm always able to win historically or why I get a hard time from the establishment is because I don't think about anything but the consumer.
Yeah.
I don't know how to. How could you possibly do that?
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
Exactly.
That's the ultimate goal.
Mm-hmm.
Like you say, what's a good marketer? You know, like you reverse engineer backwards.
Yeah.
The goal is for someone to buy your stuff. If you don't understand what's interesting to them, the biggest issue with professors in marketing is they speak in theory versus reality.
Absolutely.
Of course, reach
and not market context as well, because MENA is different to the rest of Africa.
Of course. Mm. All I think that matters is relevance. Yeah. It's why the point you just made, forget about me, you know, forget about Europe versus Africa versus America. I'm talking about Manhattan. This is a small island.
Yeah.
Do you understand how different the people that live up there, that's the Upper East Side, are than the people who live down there?
Oh, can I see
Tribeca?
The joke?
This is like a ton. This is not just America. This is not even New York State.
Yeah.
This is not even New York City.
Yeah.
This is little Manhattan.
Yeah.
And literally 20-minute walk this way and 25-minute walk that way. Mm. It's like bizarro different parts of the world.
We're staying in Times Square and we're just like, what is
that? Times Square's not even New York. It's like a melting pot of tourism.
Exactly.
And so, I think marketers are looking for simplicity.
Don't forget,
a brand manager has a lot of responsibilities besides marketing.
Yo, I know.
They have supply chain.
Yeah. price increase.
They have, which is real. Mm. They have retail relationship, distribution. They have to get along with the sales team. Mm. Like, I have a lot of empathy for everyone we're talking to on the call. That empathy doesn't allow me to look the other way.
Got it.
When the last thing they are is consumer centric.
Absolutely. No, it's well said. And the thing I want to add in is the unconscious bias as well. Because so many times we'll have brand managers sit there. Oh, I don't listen to Amapiano. Now every brand manager wants to book the biggest Amapiano DJ because it's cool now, you know?
That's right. Like that stuff I have never understood. I'll never forget, early in my career, I had a 65-year-old white male who was selling product to teenage diverse Americans say to me, but Gary, I don't get YouTube. And I said, good news. We're not trying to sell this candy to you.
Yeah.